working with other people. You are. At some point, you're going to have to talk to them. Most developers don't really like this. They like to imagine themselves as the lone wolf hacker, tearing through code into the wee hours of the morning, free of stupid time sinks like meetings. But the reality is that real development almost always happens in the context of a team, because there's a limit to what one developer can do. A well-coordinated team can tackle bigger problems, play to each person's strengths, and solve problems faster and better than if any of them had done it alone. One developer who's bad at communicating can wreck all of that. When people aren't talking to each other, the various pieces don't line up. The wrong problems get solved. Assumptions are made. Bugs creep in. Projects run late. This is just as true for working with non-programmers as with fellow developers. Somewhere on your team, there will be a manager, or an artist, or a marketing person who is vital to getting the project finished and out to the end users. If you weren't communicating with them, they can't do their jobs, and the product will suffer. So how do you get better at communication? First, treat it like any other problem, and examine the tools at your disposal. Meetings, phone calls, Skype, chat, email, passive-aggressive check-in comments. These are all ways to stay organic for the rest of the team, so don't neglect them. But you don't want to treat it just like any other problem, because now you're dealing with people. That means listening to their ideas, giving the benefit of the doubt, not assuming your way is always the right way. This is especially true when working with non-programmers, since your tendency will always be to assume that the programmer mindset right and the artist is just the same. Take a deep breath, listen to what they're saying again, assume until proven otherwise that they're just as good at their job as you are at yours. A team that communicates well will always get better results than a team that doesn't. So at this point, we've pretty much covered what it means to be a good developer. Of course, there's much more to it than just the big picture stuff. Here are some more specific tips and skills you can pick up as a developer. Number one, math. That leads through algebra and geometry. You don't have to be great at math to be a programmer, but you will need to use it. Most developers won't do a lot of advanced math, but you'll definitely use algebra, trigonometry, geometry, and basic probability in the course of your career. If you're going into game development and finance, higher math is even more important. Number two, estimation. The software industry is famous for blowing through deadlines. Sometimes by months or even years. Some of that is feature creep. It's very hard to resist adding just one more tool, but just as often, it's due to developers who are bad at realistically estimating how long something will take. Actively work on your estimation skills. Break down your piece and estimate each component. Record your estimate, see how long it actually took, and figure out where you went wrong. If you're not evaluating yourself, you're not going to get any better. Three, microeconomics. If you can't talk the basic languages of economics, supply, demand, opportunity cost, game theory, and all that, you as a suits are just going to be talking past each other. Most of the real decisions on the project will be influenced by money, and a lot of the programmers make themselves irrelevant to the decision-making process by insisting on only thinking about making the software perfect instead of what's best for business. Fourth, basic user interface design. It's basically unavoidable. At some point in your career, you're going to have to make something that an actual person will use, and most bad interfaces come from programmers. Understand common UI elements and ways to use them. Accordions, global dialogues, buttons, icons, tabs, folders, all that. Learning to see it from the user's perspective can make all the difference. It may not be enough of a designer to make it beautiful, but every programmer should be able to make something beautiful. Number five, low-level languages like C. You may not use them every day, but in fact you may never use them. But the abstractions of all the higher-level languages are built on the same basics of pointers, branching, and arithmetic. At some point in almost every industry, performance becomes an issue, and understanding how the code works at a low level is the only way to get high-performing code. Six, understanding how computers work. This means understanding you. Circumvented leads and shut shout at individual employees in the middle of the office at the slightest provocation. In the end, when their one product was forced out the door with a great deal of help from Rockstar staff, most of the people who worked on it were maliciously left off the credits because the studio heads didn't want to give credit to anyone who didn't endure this the whole way through. In fact, so many people were left off the credits that Bondi employees took it upon themselves to create a webpage offering the correct credits. And after all that, after the product finally shipped, well, the company sold off all its assets and filed for bankruptcy. And though many of us salivate over any Rockstar title, the truth is that L.A. Noire still didn't live up to what it could have been. One game, 8 years of hell, and you're out of a job. That's pretty bad. But honestly, in this industry, it's not anywhere near as uncommon a story as it should be. I mean, it took 7 years of this for these issues to even get out to the public. And therein lies the first problem of working conditions in this industry. When anyone complains about the long hours or the unreasonable management, they'll often be reminded how lucky they are to be working in this industry. I've met people who told me that during the first 2 or 3 years of their career, they were essentially intimidated into going above and beyond, all to compensate for bad business practices or incompetence from above. They were regularly told, you will never find another job in this industry if you quit. And it's true, before you ship your first game, it's really easy to think that if you lose your job, you'll never get to work on a game again. Beyond that, we often create a culture in our studios where if you leave before 7 p.m., you're looked at like a traitor. Now, I will readily admit it, I'm actually not opposed to the idea of crunch time. I think that artists will very often choose to make sacrifices for their art. I mean, there's a lot in this life that each of us have given up to walk the paths we've taken, and we don't regret it. But sacrifice must come with a purpose. There has to be a good reason. Now, we could take a whole episode talking about this, but James works from a principle called modular design. You figure out what the minimum shippable product is, and then you figure out all the ancillary features that would improve the game but don't fundamentally alter how you develop the core product. For example, shooting would be part of the core feature set in a Call of Duty game, but things like killstreak rewards would probably be one of the modular features. As a designer, you should be able to design the core of your game so that your team can create and ship it without anyone having to crunch you. Otherwise, you fail at your job. So in every department, you're going to find modular features which are going to be really hard to squeeze in without somebody doing some overtime. If people want to make a great game, they'll put in the hours it takes to make some of those extra features happen. But at least then, people know what they're crunching for. They have a purpose, and they can see an end in sight. Having specific features you're personally motivated to spend extra hours working on is totally different than a studio-wide mandatory death march, where the entire crew is putting in excessive hours with no particular goal except maybe eventually shipping the product, all because of poor planning somewhere up the chain. And that's another problem. We're just getting the hang of management and scheduling in this industry. And it sounds ridiculous to say that about a multi-billion dollar international high-tech field like this one, but the truth is that for the longest time, we as an industry pretty much relied on the idea that, oh, we'll just work extra hard if our estimates turn out to be wrong, which, as you can imagine, leads to a lot of games falling apart and never shipping at all. Also, as we mentioned a while back, we still don't have a clear idea of what a producer does in this industry, so you get wild variance in both the quality and actual responsibility to manage. But the developers aren't the only ones at fault. If you choose to work in this industry, you'll almost certainly have a project canceled or studio closed underneath you for reasons that have nothing to do with that studio. As game studio consolidation increases and more studios end up wholly owned by their publishers, a developer has less and less control over their own fate. James once worked for a company where everyone seemed to know that a particular partner studio was going to be closed by the end of the fiscal year, except the developers of the studio itself. The publisher company was just waiting a little longer for tax reasons. And the studio wasn't being closed because it was bad either, just because the project they were working on wasn't estimated to have as high a return as other potential products the publisher was thinking about. But you know, at the end of the day, it's a business. And as terrible as this can be for a developer, this really isn't the publisher's fault. If the publisher is making smart decisions to ensure that they're able to put out a wider selection of better games in the future, then sure, I understand triage is sometimes necessary. But you know what is a publisher's fault? Unreasonable demands. Often, working conditions in game studios become hellish because the publisher asks for things that simply can't be accomplished without slavish labor, and the developer has no choice but to comply. Worse still, the things publishers demand from these studios are often unnecessary or even counterproductive. The mildest of these harmful demands is the request for unreasonable milestones. James has worked with more than one publisher who feels that it's a good practice to push the development team, try to maximize the workload you can get out of them. This is fundamentally a breakdown of trust. Like we said in our publishing episode, this comes from the publisher mindset that your developers are somehow trying to cheat you or pull a fast one on you so they can be lazy. But really, if that's the attitude your developer really has, no form of aggressive milestone can help you. I mean, this is going to cheat you anyway. And if they are trying to cheat you, then you've really only succeeded in driving the team into the ground. Overly aggressive milestones force a team to crunch when it's not necessary, which leads to sloppy, rushed work and exhausted developers. Worse still, from the publisher's perspective, it often leads to corner cutting and milestone builds that are more clutched smoke and mirror tricks than real demonstrations of gameplay. But the truly tragic moments come when the publisher requests something grueling that won't even help the end product. This usually comes in one of two ways. Either the publisher's feeling pressure to have a big showing at a press or a promotional event, or the publisher's gotten a hold of some buzzword or piece of industry wisdom which they think all their games now need. Let's talk about the press demos first. Scraping together a demo takes time. It pulls team members away from the predicted development path and generally throws the schedule into chaos, especially if milestones and ship dates aren't adjusted to take account of such things. In the worst cases, a studio can get sucked into a perpetual press cycle, where after E3, they're asked to have a demo for PAX, and then a Gamescom demo.
Alright, so I'm Devontae. I'm re-uploading the assets and I'm re-uploading the updated project file, Devontae.
Sure, some of the work done from the demo.
Yeah, this thing always pops off.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Because seeing as we're running out of time, I'm going to store everything for you so you can get back to it tomorrow, okay?
Awesome. That sounds really good. Thanks for having me.
Definitely
wanted Danielle to get this done without you.
Aw, thanks, Jacob.
At least as far as we've gotten it so far.
I mean, so far what we've got is pretty decent.
So, I guess one of the things we want to do is adding Kayla's video.
Oh, Kayla made a video?
Well, we have the monster credit in the here, and I'll show you where to add that.
Nice.
I guess it's already rendered, so you don't really need to do much with it other than know where you're going to put it. But, yeah.
Because things are slowly getting better. And we as an industry are getting better at what we do with every task.
The music I will supply tomorrow.
Okay. What can you do?
Yeah.
We have the credits already done, right?
Yeah, Thomas did the credits. I will be able to find that on Google Drive tomorrow.
Alright, so we have the credits done, we have the video of the monster card being written done. I think we have all the video that needs to be done. It's just going to be editing it by putting it all together and putting in the sound.
Yep.
Walk out of here in 7 minutes, so that means plan accordingly.